generating DC by the solar system, and then we are inverting it and connecting it to the grid, then it is supplied to the system. And later, if we see that control of devices, they require again the conversion of AC to DC, and then variable frequency operation or variable speed drives, they are converted. So if we say we are converting twice, and those conversion efficiencies, they play important role in the loss making. So if there are possibilities, and we should go for that. So this is one of the research opportunity which is to be taken up by the researchers, and many people are doing on it. Then we can say that the requirement of controllers, that is, we can go for normal 220 volt appliances, then control of charging, the storage, power quality control in the grid connected system, and the maximum power extraction from the solar or the renewable system, because we say extract it when it is available. Renewable energy is such a system that when it is available, if you don't extract, it is gone. So we have to extract it, and if we have possibility of storing it, we should go for that. So in general, we can have those things, and now I can go for say the R&D challenges in wind energy systems. It is also having a similar aspect as solar, variable power generation. Selection of generator is one of the aspect which many people take up. Then matching of the power demand and supply in the wind energy system. Then system behavior under sudden changes, because here also the wind is unpredictable. Sometimes if demand is high and wind is not there, from where we'll get the supply. So we have to take up those situations, and some methodology should be there in your controller so that we can have those systems in place with uninterrupted power supply. And then control of power flow and maximum power point or maximum power tracking in these systems, that is also taken up. Now there is another aspect which is coming up as a microgrid. There are certain microgrid systems which are created for the locations which are very far from the grid or aloof from the society. You can say in the hilly areas or in remote areas. So these are known as off-grid systems. Microgrids, we can say they are off-grid systems, but there are grid-connected microgrids also. That means the size of the system is a small, that can be of a village, of a society, of a township, and that can be standalone as well as the grid-connected. And there are the systems which are available, means we can have the renewable energy sources which are there available at the vicinity of that society where the energy use is required. And they can be solar photovoltaic, wind, micro hydro, geothermal, thermoelectric, tidal, biomass, whatever it is. But there may be a situation when all these systems are inoperable. That means there is no renewable energy available. And for that, if there is even a chance of one day, we have to go for the diesel generator as a conventional backup energy source. So we call that these systems may have or may not have the diesel generator backups. I'll just discuss on these systems. And we say that they are having three basic components. One is power converter, which we call the generator, and then generator and power converter combination, then battery energy storage system, and then control and protection systems. Now there can be a situation when solar PV systems are connected to AC bus, that is known as point of common coupling, that is, it is through voltage source converter. And there can be systems in which all the systems on the renewable energy side can be connected to the DC bus, and then finally single voltage source converter can give the power to the grid. And other renewable energy sources, which they use rotating generators for the energy conversion, they can be interfaced at PCC directly or through the power converter. Now there can be classification of the two sources, three sources, four sources or more, that is on the availability of these sources. And I'll just show you a bit of combination of these systems. Now in these systems, when we call distributed generated generation units, DGU, they can be connected or tied at DC bus using the suitable converter to avoid synchronization issue with the AC bus. You may be aware that if we are having number of generators and if we want to connect them to grid, all must be synchronized to the grid frequency. So the synchronization becomes very big issue when we are having multiple number of generators. So one of the aspect or one of the solution is to convert these AC sources or AC power to the DC, then synchronize it using single converter. Although this will have losses associated with it, but it will ensure the power availability, because whenever there is a synchronization issue, there may be the systems may go out of synchronization because the power is abrupt in nature, or you can say stochastic in nature, for solar, for wind, or for any other nature. They may be available, they may not be available. So that issue can be avoided. And it also minimizes the number of power converters in the system. Then they can have doubly fed induction generator. I think Dr. Amit Jain of IIT Delhi, he has taken up this course, and they can be directly connected to the AC bus, whereas the rotor can be connected to DC bus because it can be fed from the both the sides, from the stator as well as from the rotor. So this can be used for that purpose. And these configurations, they are classified in different for different machines. The machines which can be used as the generators are synchronous generator, then we can go for a squirrel cage induction generator, synchronous reluctance generator, then permanent magnet synchronous generator, and permanent magnet brushless DC generators. These are the generators which we call other than synchronous generator, they are all brushless generators. And the advantage of these generators are that they do not require any kind of routine maintenance or frequent maintenance, because they are brushless in nature, so frequent maintenance is not required. Otherwise, if we go for the synchronous generator or any other kind of generator which are using brushes, then the replacement of brush is a regular phenomenon. You have to go for that, and then there are a lot of things associated with the brushes. So those things can be avoided if we use these brushless generators. Now this is some of the configurations which I wanted to discuss. This is on the basis of solar photovoltaic and wind turbine based configurations. And we can say that is two sources based. Now these are the suggested configurations for the places where wind and solar, both potential is available throughout the year. Because there may be places where wind is available for some time and solar is available in the daytime. And if we have such a combination that wind is available during evening and night time and solar is available in the daytime, then this kind of combination can work for 24 hours. And it requires a good wind profile throughout the year. So this is a possible combination having two sources. And here the battery energy storage system, if we see here, the battery energy storage system is also integrated with this. So battery energy storage is required for critical loading. That means the design of battery is kept in such a way that if there are critical loads, like hospitals are connected, ICUs are connected to that, if it is a microgrid supplying to that kind of system, or if there is a load center, a data center of a big computer company, then we need the backup of battery, and the size of battery should be in such a way that it can cope up the required period in which the system can be properly shut down or can be restored if we are having that kind of system. And here you can see the system A, B, C, D, they are E. They are all connected on the DC side just to avoid the synchronization issue. So there is a rectifier after the wind turbine. And if you see the other one here, we have this DFIG in which DC and AC side both are connected. So a stator can be connected on the AC side with synchronizer, and the load or the DC side can be connected through the rotor of the DFIG. So this kind of system can be designed. It depends what is the power rating available, because if less power is available, we should go for smaller machines. If the power is larger, then we should go for the doubly fed induction generator. So this is one of the systems with two sources. Now here we are taking these sources with solar and DG. Suppose there is a situation in which we are not having wind potential and the loads are equally important, so we can go for the DG. So that whenever there is availability of solar or the backup stored in the battery, we should avoid DG. This will add to our green energy concept, because if DG is running 24 hours, definitely it will contribute to more pollution. So this is one of the, I can say, options which can be given to the DG generator with the help of photovoltaic system. Then we can go for the micro hydropower. If there is availability of river in which we have a sufficient amount of water flowing throughout the year, we can go for the micro hydropower along with the photovoltaic, because micro hydropower can be used as and when the photovoltaic is not available there. So that kind of system can be designed for the remote locations where this availability of a small canal or a small contributory to the river is available. We can go for those systems. Then the similar combination can be used for the three systems. If there are availability of wind as well as water, as well as the solar system, sun, then we can go for a three system based configuration. In this, the configurations can be controlled. You can see here that most of the points, they are connected to the DC side, so that synchronization issue is not there. And they can operate, we can design such a system that these three may have the priority. That means in daytime, the photovoltaic should be operated at most. Then when there is a wind availability, the wind should be operated. And when there is no availability of wind or solar, then this micro hydropower should be operated, because the water can be stored as a reservoir to those areas. We can make a small reservoir so that whenever there is not a non-availability of these two systems, wind and solar, then we can go for the micro hydropower. And that is a kind of management at the generation site we can do to meet our load. So there can be again different generators and different machines. Then the combination, if there is a possibility that the renewable energy sources, they are not available throughout the year or throughout the day, then we can go for the diesel combination also, diesel generator. But diesel should be operated only minimum. And in that case, we can go for the demand side management also. I'll take up later on that if there is a possibility that we can avoid such some applications when there is non-availability of renewable energy sources and it is running on the diesel, then we should go for the demand side management. We can switch off some of the loads, we can control the loadings to the lowest possible units, so that can be done. And the similar thing can be done with the solar photovoltaic, DC and wind turbine. And then we can have a combination of four also, all these four combinations. But there is a precaution required when you increase number of converters, or if you increase number of sources, then the control aspect becomes critical. And in that case, your control should be designed in a proper form. Otherwise, there may be problems of prioritizing the loads, and you may not get the proper energy efficient operation of the generators. So that is most important, and this can be done through different control schemes. So I have just given a scheme which we have used in one of our papers that I had given in the reference. First reference is there, so you can go through that reference. And here we are having different kinds of combinations, because all these converters can be controlled using power electronics. So there are power electronic converters. We are using this inverter, then we are having boost converters, because the voltage level may be low or high, so we have to match it to the requirement of the supply side as well as to the load side. So that can be done. This kind of controllers can be designed. And there is one more requirement. We have here a DC dump load. We call it a DC dump load, or we can have alternative loads. This is to protect this battery. Sometimes if battery is fully charged and if we are feeding load to the battery, suppose there is no requirement on the no demand on the consumer side and the power is already generated, so for that we are having some kind of load which is we call a DC dump load, or we can have some load which in which we can have some kind of a storage, like in American and Canadian continent, they are using it as a water heating system because there is a continuous requirement of hot air to keep the houses hot during the winters because they are having a lot of winter there. So whenever there is excess power, they just go for the heating, and that heating or removing the ice from the locations where it is not desired, that is one of the applications. In some parts, this kind of load constitutes the pumped storage one. That means in place of DC dump load, there are loads such as pumping systems in which the water from the tail race can be pumped back to the reservoir, so that when there is extra energy through renewable energy sources, we can pump back the water, and whenever there is a requirement of excess power, we can again flow the water and get the energy. So with the minimum loss, which is in the pumping, we can get our power demand shifted, or you can say power generation capacity shifted to the higher requirement period. So that is important, and that is done in many cases for the control of these renewable energy sources. Here is the control for the diesel generator. So for the diesel generator, there is a definite controller which is kept in such a way that whenever there is a critical load demand, then only the diesel generator will switch on, and it has to be automated so that it can be operated as and when the critical load demand is there. Other than that, we should try to avoid the operation of diesel. So this kind of controller can be used. Just a glimpse of the controller, how we go for that, the control or control system. This is for the maximum power point. So normally we have whatever control parameter we are having, like we are having the VPV and IPV, then we process it through a PI controller, we get some control signal, then we compare it with the DC, and then finally we compare with a triangular signal to get the output. I'll just show you how this is done. And normally what we do, we have a sawtooth reference in which the error is floating between the lower minimum to the upper maximum. And between this, the PWM, you can say the pulse width, is modulated. And this is how we do in real time. So the sawtooth is kept for a particular frequency, which is optimum for your switching. That means if you are using switching of 10 kilohertz, you can have this frequency of sawtooth as 10 kilohertz. If you want less, if you want more, you can change this so that the frequency remains constant, only the pulse width is modulated. So this is the method which is used. I just wanted to discuss if somebody is interested in this. And this is a setup of microgrid. Can see a lot of machines, a lot of connections are there in the hardware setup. So if you are having 3-4 systems, you can say this is a test setup. You can just imagine this is a test setup of around 5 kilowatt. So if it is a larger system, say some 50 kilowatt, or then how much precautions you have to take, and it has to be taken care of everything. That means from the generator connections and then the controllers, all those things have to be taken care of. So here we have, this is a solar simulator. Then these are the motor generator sets. Normally we use for solar and, wind and micro hydropower generators. One is a motor in which we can control its load, torque, and the generator is then behaving like if it is having a variable input, and then these are fed to a system. Here the battery is there, the battery is kept at this point, and then some filters are here, transformers are there, and the controller is on this PC. It's a D space. We have used a D space here to control and prioritize, and the load is connected on the back of these systems. So there are resistive, inductive, and some capacitive load is also connected. So we change those values, and then we see the results for the points which we have already mentioned in our testing. Like we'll do this, because in real time there may be variable loading scenario. So we go for that, and then if the results are perfect, then we can go for the publication of these ideas. And there are many companies which are interested to make such a system. So there are systems being manufactured in Canada for Northern Ireland, where there is a large solar and hydro is available in the Northern Canada, and they are doing experimentation on these systems. And backup, we have used a diesel generator in such systems, because there may be situation when all the water reservoirs are frozen and there is no sun. Then in that situation, from where we'll get the energy? So we are having a system with solar, water, and with the diesel generator. Similar systems can be taken up in different scenarios. And we can say what can be the applications. So home lighting appliances, street lighting, community water supply, then water treatment plants for drinking water supply. These are for microgrids. You can have a microgrid of, say, 5 kilowatt, 10 kilowatt, 20, 50, all these ranges. You can go for small microgrids also. Wastewater treatment plant, then disposal system, cattle farming, chicken farming, dairies, tourist facilities such as cottage and resort, because these are all in the remote locations. Then aerial ropeway transport system. You can see this is available in many hilly areas. Then restaurant or recreation centers, mine sites and military bases. Then data centers, telecom towers, petroleum refilling stations, hospital, nursing homes, daycare centers, old age homes, EV battery charging centers on highways. This is one of the interesting applications which is coming up nowadays. And definitely it will pick up in India, because if there are more number of electric vehicles, and we know that electric vehicle can go maximum for 300 kilometers in one charging. Some are having 100 kilometer only. So if there is a requirement, if you're going for a long distance and your battery is depleting, what will you do? If it is an all electric vehicle battery, if it is not a hybrid, because hybrid, you have a possibility to use IC engine, but in electric vehicle, that will be a costly. But if you are having a pure electric vehicle, definitely you need a charging. So if we have renewable energy based charging systems on the highways, definitely we can go and have the battery charged there. And there also we require some fast charging, so that if we are staying there for half an hour, our battery is fully charged, or say 80% charge, then we can go for some 100 kilometers or 80 kilometers if it is range is 100 kilometer. So this is one of the application which may take up in coming years. And then rural irrigation system, you might be aware of this rural irrigation system based on the solar, but there can be other options also which use the irrigation or the pumps for that. Now coming to the efficiency improvement in the transmission and distribution, I'll just go for one of the system. And here I wanted to discuss one software which we are using and which one of my students have used, that is OpenDSS, Open Distribution System Simulator. It actually simulates the complete transmission or distribution line, and then it shows what are the areas or what are the lacunas in that system where you can take up the energy efficient measures. So we can have this is the glimpse of that OpenDSS. It's an open distribution system simulator, and it is available on the net. You can download. It is free of cost, and it is developed by Electric Power Research Institute, USA. And it can be used to simulate unbalanced, balanced distribution network, including all kinds of distribution generation. It has one very good feature that is called COM, Component Object Model, in which we can club this with the MATLAB software. Means you can have MATLAB program in which you can call this OpenDSS, and then you can run the desired operations in the OpenDSS. And your MATLAB will take up all those results. It can be combined with Python, and they are working for other backup softwares also, with which it can be integrated. And it can do all kinds of power flow calculations, in which you can go load flow analysis, then power balance, everything. And it is applicable for the smart grid and harmonic analysis of the system. Now, what are the elements? It is having different elements which can be programmed. One is power delivery element, in which you can have the energy transportation, then lines, transformers. Then you can have power conversion elements, in which you can have the generators, loads, energy storage, etc. And then the control elements, how to control the voltage and current or the power delivery. So these are defined. And then there are metering elements also. We can have the meters connected to different installations so that when we want to control anything, we should get the metered values. So these are the basic components available. And it is available open source. So anybody can go through the details of the OpenDSS, and it's a self-learning kind of module. So you can just go. There is a very big, you can say, user base. So if you have any problem, you can put your problem into as a query to that user base, and within, you can say, 10 minutes, 5 minutes, you get the solution, because there are many people who are ready to give you the answer solution that it is available in that way. So it is a self-learning kind of thing. This is one of the case study which one of my students has done. It is a real-time feeder. I just wanted to show you how it is done. So how we go for the specifications. Like ST line specifications are there. What is the height of the conductor, phase 1, then phase 2, phase 3. You can see here, the conductor 1 and 3 are having 7.5 meter. That means it's a kind of delta, in which this phase number 2 is based on the top, and 1 and 3 are at the bottom. So that kind of three-phase distribution is there, and spacing between the conductors is 0.54 meters. And then the LT line is there, in which we are having the neutral conductor also, and their spacing. This is important to generate the data of losses or all kinds of fault. Even fault can be simulated in this one. So these things are important to be fed into the system. And then the conductor data is required, in which you have to tell that what is the cross-sectional area of that conductor which you are using, the material of the conductor, and its distribution. What is the diameter, how it is connected, then what is the resistance of that material which you are using for the conductor, because it will calculate the losses also. And then the line code is given. The line code actually that is given that what are the values of the inductance, resistance, inductance, and capacitance parameters into the system. It is calculated on the system. Then we have to give the connections, that which feeder or which line is connected from where and what is its length. Length is given in the units, and then the line code is referred, that which code is required there. And then the transformers are given, that where are the transformers and where they are connected. What are the capacity, what is their losses, which are given on the nameplate or calculated, that is mentioned. And then the nodes, the connections, like transformer T1, it is connected to node H3, then H4, like that you have to give the connections. And then the capacitors, if there are capacitors connected to the system, then you have to mention that at which point the capacitor is connected, whether it is a three-phase system connected to the ST side or LT side, which bus it is connected, what is its capacity. Then the loads, because you have to get the complete information on that system. So load has to be given, that what are the loadings on different terminals, whether it's a single phase load or three phase load, and at which terminal it is connected, at what is the voltage, what is its connection type, what is its power factor. And then there is one term, load shape, yearly load shape. That means you have to tell what is the loading pattern of your system. So I'll just show you one of the load shape, that is yearly load shape. It takes hourly basis, and it will have 8760 points, and how it's taken like this. This is a load shape, that timings in the 1, 2, 3, these times are there, and the load shape is generated, and this is how the load shape looks like. That means this is the daily from 00 to next 24 hours, means it is in the 24 hours notation. So how the load is connected, and then this is the monthly, and this is the yearly. So here you can see that in between the summers, there is a high load showing in the yearly load curve. This has to be fed there, and then the analysis is done. Energy meters are there for connection of the losses and metered quantities of power, voltage, current. And this is how the mapping is shown. So when you run the simulation in OpenDSS, it shows this network. It's a big network of having some 3,000-4,000 nodes in the system, and how your line is connected, because you have to give the data of these lines also with their coordinates, and it gives you the information. And these dotted points are the junctions or the transformers connected to the system. Now if we say that what is the loading pattern of different transformers, and then how they behave in the system, I'll just show this part. That if you see here, the power starts from here at this point, the first point where I'm using this cursor, around 30 it is written, and then the width of this blue line, it is decreasing. That means the most of the power flows from this point. This thickness of the line shows the power flow from these lines. So if you see the system, you can easily visualize that where is the maximum power flow. If you see these lines, till this point the power flow is high, till this point the power flow is high, here also the power flow is very high, here also the power flow is very high, but at these ends the power flow is very small. And this can be done at different time. So we come to know that which area is having what kind of power flow, and we can go for the losses also. We can go for, this is for the current flow, and then we can go for the losses. So we can see that here, you see the thickness is higher, that means the losses are more in this area. So we have to work out how to reduce the losses in these areas. If you see here, the thick lines, they show the losses. And compared to your source from where the supply is fed, the losses at this point, the losses at this point, the farthest end, the losses are too much. So we have to manage that. And this is how, by the help of this OpenDSS software, if your design is proper for the system, you can analyze that where the losses are then, and then you can work out the, you can say, energy management measures or energy saving measures, and then you can recreate the system and see whether whatever you have applied is actually effective or not. So this is how the software can give you a demonstration of whatever energy saving or energy management you have applied on the system, that can be seen there. This is the voltage profile. I'll show you that this is the voltage profile. If you can see, if it is visible, here you can see this is a green line. You can see here it is a green line. After that, it is a red line at all these areas. Why it is red line? I'll show you this. This is the voltage profile of a typical feeder. It is a typical feeder of Punjab. This is a real-time case. And if you see, at the farthest end, the voltage drops to 0.4 per unit also. This is because of the load, where I'm showing you in the power, those thick lines. If the losses are there, definitely the voltage will dip to a, such a low level that your tube lights will not glow, your 100 watt bulb will glow like a 20 watt bulb or like that. So this is the real scenario you can see. we want that the voltage regulation should be within this range, 0.95 to 1.05. We call 5% voltage regulation. So it is 1 PU. This line is 0.95. This line is 1.05. And you can see up to this point only, it is within that voltage regulation. And that is why, if you see the previous slide, here few lines are green. It is up to this point. That means initial distribution lines are green. After that, the voltage regulation is very poor. So you can see that open DSS gives you the information about the power flow, about the voltage profile, about the losses, which normally is not available in any other software. And it's a very powerful software and free of cost. So for the analysis purpose, you can go for the BTech students or MTech students. Anybody can go for the projects looking at their own system. Means it is not confined to system. We can have say a 2-bus system, 5-bus system, 10-bus system, which is in your near vicinity. Collect the data, make a model, and go for the analysis. And based on that analysis, you can analyze your system where the losses are there. So transmission as well as the distribution losses, if you can manage, that can be done. And there is a simple, you can say, distribution. If you go to the previous one, you can see here the losses can be simply, if the load is distributed, definitely the losses. What we have done in this case, because this is one of the live cases we have done already, here what we have seen, that one of the phases heavily loaded, and because of that, the transformer, the transmission line, they are having unbalanced load and the losses are more. And when we balance the load, we expected, because it's a live system and it was with the Punjab State Electricity Board, so we have submitted the recommendations, and if they allow to do all those things, then definitely it will be reduced, because we have observed it in the simulations. So this, you can see the voltage profile, alarming voltage profile, you can see here that the voltage level at the farthest end goes very low in many of the cases. And these are the colors are for different phases: red, yellow, and blue. Yellow is not there, so there is a different color, red, blue, and it is a little bit, you can say, greenish color. So these three colors are there, and these are representing three phases. So you can see most of the phases here. You can see the red phases are almost red phases on the upper part, but other phases are going down. So the phase voltage, phase to neutral voltage, is goes down. Then we have the harmonics, unbalanced load in the system. And we can see that the losses here, we can see that the losses with the unbalanced load is 31.86, and if it is balanced, then it is 26.92. So there is a reduction of 5%. And if the power is used, even 1% reduction contributes a lot of things. So that kind of analysis can be done, and it can be utilized in the system for effective energy management in the transmission and the distribution sector. There is another part which is impact of harmonics. Maybe you are aware of the harmonics, because nowadays we are using a lot of power electronic devices, or we can say control devices, which are based on the switching systems or switching devices. So they generate the harmonics, they generate the frequencies which are multiple of the fundamentals, and it basically distorts or deteriorates the quality of input supply, which should be 50 hertz purely sinusoidal, but we are not getting it. So there are certain standards also for the transformers. The transformers should comply to this C57.110/1998. This is the IEEE standard which a transformer should comply. And for that, we have done the study, that effect of harmonics on a transformer, and we have seen these are the magnitudes for the 5th, 7th, 11th, 13th, 17th, 19th harmonics on 100 kVA, 200 kVA. You can see the number. There were 1200 kVA, 26 other 100 kVA transformers, and then 36 200 kVA transformers. They are connected to the system, and they were having losses. So these are the harmonics. You can say the voltage harmonics. These are the voltage harmonic values. Fundamental is given first, and then the amplitude of, this is the amplitude of, this is the voltage, 5985. This is around 6 kV. And these are the voltage of different harmonics, which is calculated by this software. And then these are the current harmonics. And then we calculated the loss, how much loss because of the harmonic load will be there. And if the losses are reduced, then what will be the effect on the system? So we have calculated, and there is a term for the transformer that we call loss of life. It is here written as percentage LOL, that is loss of life. That means if harmonics are available in the transformer, then the transformer will have loss of life. And here we have calculated by this method that with the harmonics, the transformer will go up to 18.41 years, although it could have been used till 20 years. That means there will be a loss of life, 2 years of loss of life almost for a transformer if the present level of harmonics are available. So that is one method to get, and this is one of the, you can say, factor which is calculated. So that kind of analysis is done for the transformers. And if harmonics are reduced, definitely its life will increase and the failure will reduce. Because if there is a failure in transformers, it goes for the loss of generation, or you can say loss of revenue to the utilities, and a loss of production to the system or to the industries connected to it. So there are so many things. We usually calculate only the loss of the transformer, but there are associated losses. And if all taken together, reduction of harmonics will be definitely benefiting much more as what we calculate. And these are certain things which is known to everybody, the voltage sag. So what we did, we created voltage sag in the system. Then there are classification of voltage sag, then voltage swells are there. There are so many things, and we have created, and then we saw the effect of these systems on the transformers. So that can be done as an you can say academic activity at the institute. And if it is supported by the utilities, definitely it can have application on the utility side also. There is one solution which I had missed in this presentation. For this kind of things, there is a term known as electric spring. So everybody can note down this. You can search the details of electric spring. Basically, it is a kind of inductor capacitor combination, which is now taking up recent 2-3 years. US scientists are working on it, and it is for specifically for voltage and sag and swells, and those let's say momentary transients. Because spring, usually what we say that the spring is a thing which gives a cushion to the abrupt changes. That means if there is a sag, it will give you the voltage boost, and if there is a swell, it will absorb the power, or it will maintain the voltage at a constant value. So the application of electric spring is taking up in reducing the voltage sag, swell, or you can say momentary interruptions like flicker and other things. So that application can also be taken up. And for the design, you can just search this on the web. You will get 2-3 IEEE transaction papers, good papers, and they have given very good explanation. So those things can be controlled, and that can be clubbed with these, you can say, normal measures which you use for the reduction of voltage sag and swell. So that can be a forthcoming area, or people can go for the research in that area. Then we can have some efficiency improvement in transformers if we go by the manufacturing. I'll just have a core of these systems, and it leads to good savings, but cost is higher. So I'll just show you a few figures which I have taken from certain websites. And these are how these ribbons are taken, and then they are formed in the form of pore. So they have this crystalline, see here, crystalline structure and the non-crystalline structure of amorphous, and it has this formation. This is the core which is formed from this one, amorphous metal, and this is another one which you can see. This is the sheets which are being cut and then placed for the transformer making. And these are the windings. The windings are done like this. So here we can have that they are having 70 to 80% lower the losses, no load losses. That means if there is a loss of say 2%, it can have some 1.5% loss. So that way it reduces a lot of thing for high power transformers if we can go for amorphous metal transformers. You can just go through these things. These are just elaboration of the amorphous metal transformers, how they contribute to the savings. And it can go for the, here you can see in the last point that it can go for higher frequency also, can go up to 350 hertz. So if we are having a high frequency transformer, because we know that if we increase the frequency, the size of our magnetics becomes small, inductors and other magnetic circuits. So if it is required, then we can go for amorphous metal transformers. And this is a little bit calculation of one transformer. Now we can go for the drive side. Means if we just start, we started from generation, then transmission, and then the now the application point. So from the machine point of view, if we say we are having almost in all applications the drives, maximum of the machines are now in the form of drives. We can see in our homes, even fans, we are having now electronic regulators. It's a kind of drive. We are having a track based electronic regulator. So whatever speed is required, we do it at the requirement, as per requirement. Washing machines, then our air conditioners, and many more applications we can have as a drive. But whenever we use a drive, what kind of system we are having? Because it creates at a point, it facilitates the efficiency, or it facilitates the effectiveness of the control parameter, but it generates the harmonic on the supply side. So we have to just see, there are the losses. We have written that the losses are there. Transmission losses we can reduce, then the converter losses we can reduce, then we can losses in the motor, in the drive system we can go for those losses. And because if we are having a mechanical transmission, it has losses like gears, clutches, belts, which were the old ones. So we go for the electronic system in which we are having variable speed or variable frequency drive. Then the losses in the system like throttling or in a fan, you might be aware that earlier it was a resistance based regulator, so it was having a loss. In pumps also we were using throttling, in compressors we are using the some kind of valve to control the pressure. So those things we avoid if we are using the drive system. So this is a depiction of that. If we are having adjustable speed drive, we can have the output as per requirement without the losses. That is the most important part of the solid state control or power electronic control drives. Adjustable speed drive, variable frequency drive. These are all similar, synonymous. So we have all those things. And you can see that the power efficiency improves in the system. Here you can see the 0.16 and 0.32. Now, what are the reasons? We should think on the reasons point of view. So with my experience, I have some points to discuss. One is over design. Normally, whenever we design a motor, everywhere, when we calculate the load, we take some over design factor. Then when we calculate the transmission, of the load, then we again take the over design factor. Then when we go for the rating, we take again over design. So if your design has 2, 3, 4 stages, your over design reaches somewhere 1.5 to 1.75, sometimes double of the rating. And when you run the machine, even at full load, the machine is running at 50% load or 60% of the load. So that is the first thing which should be taken care of when we are designing. The safety margins should be taken optimally. It should not be taken vaguely that, okay, take 1.25% or 1.5% like that. Then the second practice which we are having in the Indian system, rebound machines. Whenever there is a problem of machine occurs or something, we go for a rewinding. And whenever there is a rewind machine, definitely there will be change of air gap or other parameters. Therefore, the operating point, optimum operating point is shifted and the machine efficiency may not remain the same. So that is one of the losses point which we can take up. And then inefficient control methodologies that we have already discussed, throttling, gear belt pulley arrangement or the resistive voltage control. Then the drives, if we select improper motor drive or improper drive rating, then also the losses can be there. Now what should be done? We should use solid state converters, then energy efficient motors. You might be aware of energy efficient motors. There are many machines available in the market which are known as energy efficient, and they are having the design in which their no load losses are reduced very, I can say, to the minimum level, and their other losses are also with the proper, you can say, cooling arrangements and other things. The load losses are also tried to be reduced, so their efficiency increases by 1% to 4%. Or 5% in a range for different manufacturers. So those motors can be used. Then use of optimum rating motors. That means it should not be over-designed. And use of variable speed drives. Then energy efficient operation of the drives. We have to go for the energy efficient operation. Then improvement of power factor, because if we are using AC motors, the power factor will be a problem and power factor must be improved. So for improvement of power factor from the supply side, you can increase the efficiency. Motor losses will not be changed, but from supply side, because for the same KVA rating, the power drawn will be different if power factors improve. Then improvement of power quality, use of single phase to three phase converters in rural applications. And this is why I have written, because I had observed in some places that people are running three phase pumps. And even if there are one phase or two phases available, they connect a capacitor to any one of those two phases and they run the three phase motor. And that practice is common in many of the rural areas, because electricity board, specifically in MP, what they do, they stop the supply of one phase to avoid the application of three phase loads during the peak hours. But it is leading to the overloading of remaining two phases, so that the voltage imbalance is there and losses are increased. So that is why I had written this. Use of capacitor for those conversions. It is better to use a single phase to three phase converter in rural applications, so that at least the load is balanced in that case. Then the regular and preventive maintenance of the motors, transformers and the coupled equipments. In solid state converters, we can say replacement of resistance controllers by the fan, for the fan by light dimmers, electric traction or any such application. Then replacement of eddy current coupling for speed control of induction motors. We can go for the drives. And then this is old, sometimes Bode-Leonard drives are also used in many industrial applications, so we can go for those. Then use of energy efficient motors, it reduces losses and the power factor is also improved with the low temperature rise. Then we can go for the optimum rating motors. We should not go for the over design motors. The cost will also be reduced. Okay. And the power factor and efficiency will also be having good if optimum rating machines are used. Then we can go for the variable speed drives. Depending on the requirement, we can go for the flow control and other parameter control in the industrial or commercial sectors wherever it is desired. Energy savings can be achieved by this speed variation. And one of its example, which nowadays you might be aware of, air conditioner, which we call inverter technology. So what that inverter technology is doing? Normally, in our previous cases, everybody is having those on-off control matrix. Whenever the temperature goes below certain set value, your compressor becomes off. And whenever temperature again rises, the compressor becomes on. So this is a kind of on-off control, which we were using, and again, we are also using since long ago. And now this inverter-based technology is coming. They are using a specific type of compressor that is called a screw compressor, in which the speed determines the amount of material compressed. So it is a temperature-controlled one. And if the temperature gap is reduced, then its speed is reduced. If any of you are having this one, the AC with the control inverter based, then you can see that this AC never switches off. Its speed is varied. That means you can hear the sound of reducing speed when the temperature reaches, and whenever there is a temperature increase, its sound increases. So it's an application of variable speed drive directly to that kind of application. And this gives a lot of saving. You can see the literature, even whosoever is having that, their electricity bills itself, they speak that, yes, it is having value saving. So that is how you can have in different applications. Just you have to apply your know-how where it can be used. But there is a problem in this kind of electrical drives. They are having pulsed input current waveform. Their TSD is high, crest factor is high, the power factor at AC mains becomes poor, and these are known as power quality disturbances, which has to be addressed. And there are some power quality standards, IEC 55552, 51961. This is IEC 61000032 is for the devices less than 16 ampere. If we say that what are the opportunities in electrical drives, so high efficiency motors, there are people working on high efficiency motor design, then adherence to international power quality standards, you have to improve the power quality, then loss reduction in the drive system, sensors and control complexity reduction, because when you are using lot many sensors, the control becomes complex and then you are lost in those control complex and the cost also becomes high. So that way also you can go for reduction of cost and control complexity. Cost reduction of the drive and machine itself, can go for the technologies so that the cost is reduced. Then the fast and efficient controllers using the processors, digital signal processors or low cost processors, and then optimization in design and performance. So these are the applications you can go for that. And how you can proceed, we can have the motor selection based on the load, technology or topology selection for converter and inverter, then control strategy selection. These are the points on which the problems can be taken up. And design and simulation, you can have simulation software. Usually we go for the MATLAB, but people may go for other softwares also. Then the device selection, depending on the frequency which we are operating, MOSFET or IGBT. Then the controller based on the cost and application, and then prototype development. You have to generate the prototype. If you want good publication, then definitely you have to generate the prototype, and then its result must be validated, whatever you have proposed. Now I'll just come to case study. This is a case study which is based on my research and one of my two of my students. So here, if you say how we go for those things, if you see here, this is a permanent magnet brushless DC motor drive, in which we are using two current sensors, and then the position sensing is there. And this side, for power quality improvement, we are using one current sensor, one voltage template sensor, and one DC link voltage sensor. So effectively we are using here three this side sensor and almost three sensor on this side. So six sensors are being used. And what is the target? Actually, this drive has this kind of voltage and current waveforms. You can see the current waveforms are having peaks. So these waveforms have to be made sinusoidal so that there is no harmonic and the power factor is almost unity. However, the load side has this kind of waveform. This is the voltage waveform, trapezoidal, and the current is having square current waveforms with the flat in between. Now this is the target. So what can be done? This is a normal converter, normal controller for power quality as well as machine. So what we did, we had gone for this side reduction of the current sensor and then this position sensing we have taken. And what we did, we just controlled from the this side. We used only one voltage sensor and one, this side sensors are same, we have controlled here. Now to current control, because the current will not be controlled in this case, so what we did here, we used equivalent reference voltage generator and the rate limiter. We have just limited the rate of rise of current so that if there is a large voltage available, the current should not go to extremely high so that the machine is saved. So this is what we have done, and there are publications related to this. This is my work in PhD, I did it. Then later on, what we did, one of my students, he tried to reduce on this side also and this position sensing also. So we go for that. Here you can see that we have reduced the template sensor also from this side. And for that we had gone with a converter in which we are using only a DC-DC DC link sensor and here only the position sensor. So we reduced four sensors from this one and only two are used. And later on, we had gone for the position sensorless also. That means we have not used any kind of position sensor. Go through this configuration part. Actually, it is required to have isolation between the converters, then the voltage ratio, number of switches, DC link voltage, and operation of converter. Based on this, the classification are done. And I had just classification. This is the, you can say, broad classification of the converter topologies in which we can have isolated and non-isolated. Then there are three basic topologies: buck, boost, and buck boost. Then there can be single switch, two switch, three switch, single, two and four switch converters. And then some specific like flyback, Kuk, SEPIC and JITA converters. And then there we can have the constant voltage control and the variable DC link voltage control with the continuous conduction mode of operation and discontinuous conduction mode of operation. So if you see by this classification, there will be a lot of converters and controllers which can be used for the system. And it becomes somewhere 72 or something control schemes. These can be taken up, and they are having individual advantages, disadvantages for these systems. So that can be taken up. This is also taken from one of my papers, and that is available in reference. So you can go through if anybody is interested to see how it is done. And these can be replicated to different machines. It is not only limited to PMBL-DC machines, means permanent magnet brushless DC machines. It can be replicated to any other machine because it is a power quality control method in which we are controlling it at the DC link and before the DC link. After that, you have inverter. If you are having AC drive, you can have inverter and you can control it on the other side also. Now coming to the next part, which is demand side management. This is much talked in the utility side, and it is very important to discuss this. Without this, I think energy management cannot be completed. So in the demand side management, we say that it is the utility's influence on the consumer's capability and willingness. Because normally it is known as demand side management, and the consumer should do at itself, should do from his own side. But there are many consumers who do not bother about these things. That's why it is forced from the utility side. And what are those things which govern the demand side management. It is for the improvement of the efficiency and best use of the electricity or the energy which is being supplied to consumers. So there are methods which we call peak clipping or peak shaving. That means if there is a peak, we should cut it. The peak should be reduced so that our load curve becomes flat. And that is the most important thing, because if there is a demand, peak demand somewhere, then definitely our generator should match that demand. So suppose that demand is for 1 hour only. Out of 24 hours, it is only for 1 hour. And we are meeting that, definitely we are underutilizing our generation capacity. And that's where the demand side management becomes very important. So if we reduce that, we can manage it with the less generation capacity if the peak shaving or peak clipping can be done. So that is the most important thing. And it is done by the direct control of consumer appliance. So there are methods of these things that I'll discuss. Then related to this, the term is known as valley filling. The valley filling is that if you are having a load curve, I'll just go to the load curve, I think. Yeah, this one. See this last one. The curve is like this. So if we can reduce this peak and distribute this load to this side and this side of this load curve, definitely this will become a flattened curve. And that is why the term valley filling is there, that this side is valley. So if we can cut it here and fill it here, shift it this side, that is called valley filling. And when you combine these two things, peak clipping or peak shaving with the valley filling, it is known as load shifting. So I'll just come to that slide. The load shifting, it involves both the things. So that the peak hours load can be shifted to off-peak hours and the load curve becomes flat. And that is very important. So here, what we do, those non-critical loads like space heating, cooling storage, domestic hot water storage, or any other non-critical load, that can be shifted to those off-peak hours so that your load curve becomes flat. That is a form of demand side management. Then there is a flexible load shape. Actually, it involves to allow the customers to purchase the power at the lower than the normal reliability. That means if there are certain reliability issues, that means there may not be the power available, or there can be a chances of power outage during those periods, if it can be shifted. Or there is a term known as time of the day tariff. The people are using, in some countries, they are using that when there is a peak load, the tariff changes. And when there is a less load, the tariff becomes very cheaper. So the persons are given notifications based on the time of the day that now the power is this one, power is this one. So if power becomes cheaper, then the people can use those non-essential loads at that time. Like in our homes, if we say the application of mixer grinder or the washing machine, it is a kind of, we can say, non-critical load. Suppose you have a power which is very cheap, at that time you can use your mixer grinder, you can use your washing machine, you can use a vacuum cleaner. That means you can have the cleaning at that time so that you save the money as well as you flatten the curve. So those things can be prioritized. That is a kind of demand side management which can be done. So energy conservation, basically it refers to the both demand and total energy consumption, and it can be used by the different motivation factors. Like here we are having use of LEDs, use of five-star fans, five-star appliances, five-star ACs, so that we get the benefit of those energy conservation equipments. Then comes the strategic load growth. It refers to the general increase of electricity sales beyond the valley filling and a spontaneous effect on the economic growth. That means we prefer, if we are having larger energy, we ask the people to use it more so that our generating stations, they can have the sale of the electricity. So this is how it is represented. And we can say that these load management approaches, they are used by the utilities to increase the efficiency of the system. And all these things, they lead to good flat load curve. Okay. And what is done in that case, that is direct load control, load limiters, then commercial and industrial programs, frequency regulation, time of use pricing, which I discussed, then demand bidding, smart metering, and then smart appliances. These two are coming nowadays, that if you are having smart metering or smart appliances, some people are having IoT based these things. So if there is this time of use pricing, then smart metering or smart appliances can be programmed in such a way, if you are having, say, just for example, the washing machine, if you program it that whenever the cost comes below this, you operate it automatically. So if you are in your office and your that washing machine can operate there, and it gives you the desired output, and you go back to your home, the clothes will be all clean with the automatic system. So that can be done. And how they can be used? They can be used as a national scale, that it can be a national scale program or utility scale program, or it can be a community scale program, and the local community also it can be implemented, and to reduce the effects of losses, to minimize the losses and get the energy efficiency. Even it can be done at the household scale if the person is using that. And one thing which I have added, use of rooftop photovoltaic system for household. That can be one of the system in which you can have a bi-directional metering. And if you are having excess power, you can supply it to the grid, and you can use it at your home, so that whenever there is a demand in the night, if you have fed in the daytime, you can get equal amount of power in the night. So bi-directional metering is that kind of application with the root of photovoltaic system. One more thing which is coming up nowadays, with electric vehicle coming into the market, there is a term known as G2V and V2G, that means grid to vehicle and vehicle to grid. That means if you are using electric vehicles which are charged, you are going to your office, connected to the system, so that if at that time required power is less, that means the demand is more and the generated power is less, your vehicle can be used, your vehicle battery can be used as a source, and the power can be taken to the grid. And if your time is fixed to leave the office, before that your battery will be charged to such an extent that you reach your house and then again you plug in. So that kind of applications are coming up, and people are working on it. That grid to vehicle and vehicle to grid operations of electric vehicles, and hopefully this will also be added to this kind of management system. Then the real time pricing or time of use pricing, which already I have discussed, and then energy use charges, maximum demand charges. This is already done in many of the countries, that we have two part tariff. You have maximum demand charges, and then separate from that energy use charges, and then the penalty is imposed if your power factor is poor. So these things are done from the demand side management point of view, so that your load is properly balanced. And the challenges are that convincing the customer to spend to save the energy efficient measures. This term, spend to save, that means if you want any energy efficient appliance to be installed in your home, first you have to spend. And that is the main task, to convince a customer that, okay, if you are doing it like what government is doing for LEDs and other things, that they are giving subsidies. So that is a method to convince the customer that yes, you get it. And then later on, they withdraw the subsidies. Then the free electricity policy of the government, this is the, you can say, very bad part. We give free electricity to many of the sectors of the society. So it's by government, it's a non-debatable issue, but it is also a challenge in the demand side management. Then extreme temperature and humidity levels during summers and the rainy season. This is one of the problem when we say that shifting the load or shifting the things, people don't bother. Whatever cost is there, we'll see later on. Pehle to AC chalna chahiye. So that way, this is a very challenging task. Then battery storage based UPS system as backup of the power cut. Everybody is using, and that creates a problem for the system. It increases the maximum demand, because whenever the power comes, this UPS starts charging immediately. So if that charging can be shifted to the low peak hours, then that can be one of the good things. And then the awareness about the energy and environment relationship to the people. Most of the people now after Corona, definitely they must have understood the awareness about the environment and the energy relationship. I hope it is there. So we can go for the load curves. And I think, yeah, I have taken a lot of time. So I'll just quickly go for the load curves. It's a, you can say, this kind of load curves are there, and we go for the flattening of the curve that already it has been discussed. I'll just talk about the supervisory control and data acquisition system. SCADA, it is used many of the at many places. It is basically used for the industrial systems where programmable logic controllers or other hardware modules, they are used to prioritize the things and get the control parameters from the system. Basically, it generates control action to monitor the measured variable from the central location to a widely distributed process, such as oil and gas, pipeline system, hydroelectric, or any such system. So the successful operation of the SCADA system is based on the accuracy of the data acquisition system. And the data acquisition system is a process of relieving control information from the equipments. And it's a bi-directional control system so that we can have data and then we can have the control. And it is done for the continuous monitoring because it requires information from the system which may lead to some problem or it is already out of order. So it is necessary to take a decision for a particular situation. So it should be a continuous one. Data acquisition should be continuous one. And it is based on the, you can say, wireless control. So I'll just show you a system where we are having, say, this is a central control room, then master control unit is controlling with the, communicating with this. Some can be wired, some can be wireless communication. And the main terms known as human machine interface, HMI, then master terminal unit, MTU or MCU, master control unit, sometimes it is said, then remote terminal unit, RTU, and then data transmission in between. So HMI is basically, it facilitates the human operator to operate with the system, communicate with the system, and it's a real-time monitoring process. So that is involved. If it is automated, then this HMI is reduced if automated system is there. Then you can have master control units or master terminal unit. It is a main controller which communicates with the remote terminal units, and it has the capability to control and monitor the operations and give the necessary instructions as per its program. Then remote terminal units, it's a slave kind of thing, which takes the data, sends to the master control unit and takes the signal from master control unit and sends to the actuator signals to the end users. So it can be through radio communication or through the line communication. And these are the advantages of the SCADA system: long distance monitoring, long distance training, then protection, data management, automated operation, reliability, robustness, rich functionality. There are many SCADA software available, open source and paid. I'll just show you. So if you just see these softwares, you can see here a list of software which is available free. And if anybody is interested to work on these issues, you can go for that. So that is how you can have this one. And then I'll just come to this. Then there can be other one also. You can just click it there. One software which is open space, open software, is given by the Schneider Electric EcoStruxure. This is a good one. You can go for if anybody is interested to work on it, SCADA software. So you can just see this one. And there is an advanced version that is Foxborough SCADA of the Schneider Electric. They are having some advanced features in that one. So these are the SCADA software which can be used for the system. And these are the things through which I have taken the references. You can go for these references. Thanks. And it's time for the queries, if we have some queries. So you're most welcome for the queries. Any queries from?
Madden, can you hear
me? I think everybody is muted. So, if Nick, there is any query, you can ask.
There is an option in this. So, if anybody is having any kind of query, please raise your hand so that we may unmute you to ask your query.
This presentation you have recorded?
Yes, sir, we have recorded.
Okay, so if anyone is having, because I have already given my mail ID in the first slide.
Okay.
So they can communicate it that way. I think it's a very long presentation and everybody has seen it, and maybe they will take time because many things I have tried to touch. So if they are having any problem, if they are from Bhopal, they can call me anytime. They can meet me at Manit. I'll answer their queries, and they can even mail me at that address.
I think Manju madam is having query, so I'm just unmuting her. Manju ma'am.
Hello, Sanjeev sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you have given very good presentation. I have gone through everything. You have told something about SCADA system also.
Yeah.
So how we use that SCADA system basically?
For the research purpose, if we see the research purpose, the SCADA is basically, it is for the industrial control. And the protocols are already defined. So from the research point of view, if we see these SCADA softwares, they are of very limited use. So what we do normally, if we feel that in a particular SCADA software some features are not available, then we go for you can say improvement of those features with some other system, which we have already, like OpenDSS and MATLAB and other simulations. And then we suggest that these features can be added to these SCADA softwares. Because these are open source, you can put the queries to the community and they take up those queries.
Actually, sir, some of our students make the project in PLC and SCADA system.
Okay.
So PLC, the students are aware how to, like in bottle filling plant or in some drives control, they do the project, but how they can utilize SCADA system in project work purpose?
Those open source can be taken up in the laboratory, and see whatever control they are using for the PLC, because the operation of the PLC will depend on the control signal which is given through some kind of controller.
Okay.
So that way the SCADA system can be used for the decision making. That means the control parameters can be taken, and then for actuation that SCADA system can be used through those PLCs.
Okay. Okay, means at the higher level we will use the SCADA system, at the lower level means as a RTU we will use that PLC, and for MTU and all we will use SCADA system.
Yeah, if there are many control systems, then we can have the SCADA at the centralized location, even if it is wired connected, wired one. Then we can go for those systems, and then we can program, we can make a decision making into the SCADA system and prioritize the things. So that suppose there is only one control, there is no need to go for the SCADA system. It can be done only by the PLC. But if there are multiple functions, multiple controllers, then they can be taken at one remote location, at one control unit, and then all the things can be monitored from there, and accordingly the signals can be given to those systems.
Yeah. Okay, sir, thank you so much.
Thank you.
thank you so Sanjeev sir for giving your precious time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sanjeev sir. Thank you for this wonderful participant. I hope after lockdown we'll get a chance to invite you at our institute and interact with our faculty.
Sure, most welcome.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
So we are having
a at 3 p.m. So I request if you can attend the same after 10 minutes.
No. Actually, I have to go for some other work also. So I'm sorry. You please carry on. And thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So everybody participants are requested to rejoin at 3 p.m. Assistant professor will join the session. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. All the participants, take care.
Okay, sir.